Hello everyone, and welcome to the presentation of our paper, with the title ReconfROS, Running ROS on Reconfigurable SoCs. My name is Steffen Hindering, and I'm a master student at the Osnabrück University. Let me first give some motivation as to why we wrote our paper. On the one hand, we have reconfigurable system-on-chips, or SoCs for short. These often come with FPGAs, which are capable of running algorithms directly on hardware. Reconfigurable means that they are very flexible and you can use one FPGA to accelerate multiple hardware algorithms and are only not only confined to one, which you were if you would build hardware especially for your algorithms. On the other hand, they provide a very good power consumption and speed because the algorithms still run on real hardware and therefore don't need as much energy and can be very much faster in compared to if you would run them on standard CPUs. On the other hand, for drones we have the ROS, robot operating system, or ROS for short. It is already commonly used in robotics as it provides an easy interface for implementing robotic algorithms. We have ROS nodes, which are used for different tasks of a robotic system, and these ROS nodes communicate via ROS messages with each other. There already exist many algorithms in ROS, that's why we want to use the robot operating system also with all robotic systems. For drones. As you can see, both worlds provide very good advantages for drones. That's why we wanted to implement a system which combines these two worlds and also the advantages. That's why we implemented ReconfROS. That is the system that is capable of running ROS on these reconfigurable SoCs. Let me now explain how our system ReconfROS works. Here we can see a typical ROS scenario. On the one hand, we have our computer, which runs a ROS master on its processor, and also some ROS nodes. And we can also communicate via ROS messages with other ROS nodes, which maybe run on external systems. For example, here we have sensor data coming in and motor control to control the motor of the robot. This is a typical system, and most of the time the computational heavy parts of this ROS system lies in these nodes that run on the main processor, which also runs the ROS master. These algorithms we now want to accelerate using the reconfigurable SoCs, especially running the algorithms on hardware. That's why we first now swap the conventional computer that is used here for a reconfigurable SoC. Here on this slide, implementation-wise, nothing changed. We still have the ROS system here running on the processor of the SoC, and it still communicates with other ROS nodes on in external messages. In order to be able to run the ROS system on the processor, we also need to run the operating system Linux on the processor. That's why we do that, but if we have that, nothing hinders us to run the ROS system on the processor, even if it's an embedded processor on a SoC. On the other hand, here on the SoC, we have the FPGA and the shared memory. The FPGA is now used to accelerate the algorithms, and communication is done via the shared memory that we can see here. As you can see, we now communicate from these ROS nodes with the FPGA back and forth. The nodes are still used to communicate with the external world. They are still normal ROS nodes that publish and subscribe to various ROS topics, but the implementation and computation heavy algorithms are now accelerated using the FPGA, which is part of the reconfigurable SoC. The communication between the processor and the FPGA is done via shared memory. That's here drawn in the middle. And in order to be able to access this shared memory, we need to access it using the real addresses in this memory, because we needed to implement the ROS system on a operating system. If we try to access these addresses directly, we only get virtual addresses, which are provided by the operating system. That's why we had to tell our system to get the real addresses. That's one important contribution of our ReconfRoS system. As you can also see here, it's possible to accelerate multiple algorithms or parts of algorithms on the same node. It's also possible with our system. Now, to evaluate the system, we needed an algorithm that runs on it. And for that, we picked a typical robotics use case. In our case, we picked a trail detection algorithm. This trail detection algorithm already existed. It was published in a previous paper, and it works as following. First, we take a camera image as an input. On this camera image, we use a Gauss filter to remove the noise in this image. We then extract pixels that are part of a track using a color filter. In our case, we used a green color filter because the environment was always green around our tracks. As you can see here, they are now black. Then we used thresholding to get a binary image from this grayscale image. In this binary image, there are still some fragments left. In the next step, these fragments are then removed. Here we had to make a slight difference, change to the algorithm compared to the original algorithm. The original algorithm used to find the biggest contour in this image as in removing of the fragments. But in order to improve the hardware compatibility, we swapped that step by using now morphological transformations, especially opening and closing of the black and white pixels to get rid of the fragments. Then, when we have this black and white image with the track clearly defined, we use a weighted average over the y-coordinate to get the direction in which the track lies. As you can see in the last picture here, we have now the track direction drawn in. We also evaluated the effects of this change that we made here in the second to last step, but found out that it didn't make much of a difference. In both cases, the robot was able to follow the track using both algorithms. Now I'm going to show you a short video showing the algorithm in action. As you can see here, the six images in the video are the same images of the steps of the algorithm that I already explained. The video was done by controlling the robot by hand. If we used the output of the algorithm to control the robot, we would not get interesting results, because it would always drive in the middle of the road. As you can see here, we start on the right side of the road, and the arrow is also pointing to the left side, indicating that we are driving too much on the right side. Now we are going to move to the other side to also check for that, if that works also. And as you can see, while moving from right to left, the arrow moves accordingly from left to right. And now we are on the left side, and the arrow indicates that we should drive to the right side, because the track is now on the right side. Now I'm going to tell you about the implementation of our algorithm. While implementing our algorithm, we were able to benefit from two sides now. On the one hand, Because we were using the FPGA to implement algorithm, we were able to use a hardware-in-the-loop approach. We first implemented everything completely in software to also check if the algorithm even works, but it did. And then we implemented part by part on the hardware and could always go back and forth between hardware and software to be able to check if the algorithm still works the same and as expected. And these changes were easily made because we first implemented the software solution. On the other hand, we were able, because we now use ROS also to implement everything, to work with simulated environments and real environment respectively. That's here the y-axis in this matrix. First we tested the algorithm maybe in simulated environments, and then if everything worked we would go outside and check if it also works with real conditions, and could also here go back and forth every time we made a change or wanted to only prototype, then we maybe would rather use the simulated environment. This gives us a total of a 2x2 matrix, as you can see here, and we were able to quickly and easily swap between each cell of this matrix, so that we could then, last but not least, be able to really use the algorithm in the real world and with hardware acceleration. Having now the algorithm, we could then go on and evaluate our system by doing some experiments. First, I'd like to tell you what hardware we used for both approaches. This pure software approach, that was the baseline, was implemented on a NUC mini computer. This computer was already used in our robot systems and is commonly used for robotics and drones because it's compact and can fit on a robot but still run everything ROS related and also the operating system. On the other hand, the hardware was implemented on a pink board, which is based on a Zynq FPGA. The hardware implementation was done using high-level synthesis, which is based on C++. And in the next table here, you can see the resource utilization, which our system used. And as you can see, the Zynq FPGA was capable of running our algorithm. We still had some room left, which we could maybe use for implementing another algorithm on this FPGA, or maybe we could decide to go for a smaller FPGA, but if the runtime or the power consumption didn't fit our needs. That's what we also measured next. We used an image size of 1280 by 720 pixels to run our algorithm, and then first measured the runtime. And as you can see in the table, we were able to significantly reduce the runtime using the hardware acceleration, as we first with only software needed to take 52 milliseconds to process one frame, while with the hardware solution we only needed about 18 milliseconds to process one frame. Next, we measured the power consumption. The power consumption was measured of the whole board or the whole computer respectively. That's what would also in the system be exchanged for another. That's why that's a good comparison to make. We did measure the power consumption by taking two measurements respectively. First, we measured the whole system while it was idling, and then we measured again with the algorithm running. Taking now the difference between these two, we were able to approximate how much power the algorithm itself really needed, because that's the value that would interest us the most. And that's here in this table in the last column seen, and as you can see, it is also significantly reduced power consumption compared to the software solution. Having now the runtime and the power consumption, we could also calculate the energy that is used per frame. And this value is even more impressive because we were able to reduce the energy used per frame to about 15 times. To conclude, we presented ReconFrost, which combines the advantages of both worlds of ROS and of reconfigurable SoCs. We then demonstrated and evaluated our system using a standard robotics use case. In our case, we used a trail detection algorithm as an example. By the way, the implementation of both ReconFrost and also the example algorithm are publicly available at this link here. And the evaluation results were that we managed to significantly reduce the runtime and the power consumption. As for future work, we are now working on using our system to also accelerate other robotics algorithms. Especially now we are working on a TSDF-based SLAM, which is an algorithm which can really benefit from the acceleration on hardware because it's much more computationally heavy than the simple trail detection algorithm that was used here. We really need the hardware acceleration to be able to do that in real time. Here in the last images you can see some previews of that. Here's our system with the laser scanner, which is used to as an input for our SLAM, where we want to get our pose every time, every frame. Here we can see our system in action. It is fitted into a backpack and works with an battery. Here on the right side you can see some of our results. We already went through a room here and still managed to keep the pose intact. That's it for our presentation. Thank you very much for your attention, and now on to the questions.